Good morning. Today we'll discuss measuring data similarity and dissimilarity in data mining concepts and techniques. In data mining, there are different applications are there, like data clustering and outlier, nearest neighbor classification, like that. So everywhere we need to assess the similarity and dissimilarity of the given object. To find the similarity and dissimilarity of the object, we have number of methods. And before that, why we should find the similarity and dissimilarity? See, when you take a store, there we have n number of products. So to cluster the products, we have to find out the similarity of the product. The similarity will be based on the features of the product. Like it can be a brand, or it can be cost, or it can be color, or it can be size or weight. Like that, based on the features of the product will be identified, or the product similarity will be compared with other product. By that, we'll have a cluster of the products. Once if you cluster the product, then it will be easy to access by the customers. The same way, to develop the business, if you want to cluster the customers based on the income, based on the residence of the main area, and based on the interest, we need to have a cluster of the customer. So once if you cluster your customers, then based on the customer group, we can promote your product. Okay. So for particular age group people, they will search for this type of product. For particular income people, they will search for this type of product. So according to their interest, according to their requirements, you'll be able to promote your product. So for our business development, we need to have the knowledge about similarity and dissimilarity. And to find the to measure the data similarity and dissimilarity, we have number of methods in data mining. So we'll see one by one. And before that, we'll see the conditions for similarity and dissimilarity when you have numerical with respect to numerical values. Now you can take a similarity. In similarity measure, there if you take the value like 0 and 1, okay, the 0 and 1 is the distance between two objects. So the distance between two objects, if it is 1, with respect to similarity, the similarity is very high. That means the numerical or the value will be high in similarity. The same way, when you go for dissimilarity, there if you try to compare these two different objects, the two different the distance is 1, then these two objects is having more dissimilarity. So which category you are going to take? If you take similarity, there that numerical value must be high. If you take dissimilarity, there the numerical value must be high. Okay. Suppose in dissimilarity, the distance between two objects is 0. Okay, then this the two different object is similar. And here the proximity is similarity and dissimilarity. Now we'll go for data matrix. And previously we have seen only a single attribute. But when you go for n number of attributes, obviously we need to go for data matrix. In data matrix, here we have taken n objects. Okay, this is n object. Now the objects, n objects having n number of attributes, the attributes we can define as a p attribute. See, here if you take n object, there you can, for example, you can take person is an object, and items, and then course. So for example, we have taken three objects. These three objects can be described by p attributes such as age, height, weight, or gender. Like that, these objects will be described by their attributes. Now, if you take two objects, if you take two objects, say for example x1 and x2, and this x1 will be described by their attributes like x11, x12, x so on so x1p. The same way for the object 2 can be described by their attributes x21, x22 and x2p. So when you have n number of attributes, when you have n number of attributes, these attributes can be placed in the matrix structure. This is a matrix structure. So here you have n objects and p attributes, and these will be placed in the matrix in the form of relational database. In relational database you have rows and columns. Here also you have rows and columns. Okay, so these are the rows and these are the columns. Okay, so like that you can place all your n number of attributes in the matrix format. By that you can have n number of attributes to take care of similarity and dissimilarity process. And the data matrix have n data points with p dimensions, and it is the two modes in the sense, one is row, another one is column. Here if you take a matrix, one is a row, another one is column, so we have two different modes. In case of dissimilarity matrix, there are n points but registers only the distance. So when we take two object, if both object distance is zero, then it will put it over here in the matrix zero. For example, here if you take this place, it is 1 1, the place is 1 1 1 1, in the sense both are same. If both are same, in dissimilarity the value will be zero. Why? Because in dissimilarity, if you find that what the dissimilarity in between two objects, then the value will be very high. If the value is zero, then it will be similarity. So that will become zero. So here these are all dissimilarity. This is a similarity. This is a similarity. Similar product. These are the similar objects. So all these similar objects will be put it over here as a zero. Why? Because it's a low value. And then here we have taken only dissimilarity matrix. Okay, so dissimilarity matrix, only dissimilarity objects will be taken over here, and here you can take 2 1 3 1, so and so. For readability we have put in triangular values. Okay, and suppose if you have dij equal to dji, then that will be considered as a dissimilar. For example, d21, and somewhere here you will get d12. So both will, if you put it over here, it will become similar. So this will be removed. So we have taken only dissimilar attributes over here. It is a single mode. Why? Because the value is given in the row wise. Okay, so it is a single mode. And here the data in the form of data matrix can be transformed into dissimilarity matrix before applying any such algorithms. So first of all, if the data matrix is given, it should be transformed into this dissimilarity matrix, then the algorithm can be applied. Okay, right. So next we'll go for the proximity measures for nominal attributes. The proximity measures for nominal attributes can take two or more state. Okay, two or more state. So these are nominal attributes. For example, if you take map color, the map color will be red, yellow, green, pink and blue. Here you have five state, 1 1 2 3 4 5. You have five states. Okay, even you can take 1 2 3 4 5, like also even you can take some numerical value also, but these value will help you to handle the data, not to have any specific order over here. Okay, So this is very important. Here to identify the state, you can have even number also, but it won't give you any specific order. In simple matching, okay, we have two different method. We have two different methods. Okay, in method one, it is a simple matching. There, for example, say M equal to the number of matches. M equal to number of matches, and P is the total attributes. P is the total attribute. Then, if you have like this, then dissimilarity can be computed for two objects like I and J. That will be similarity of I and J. Okay, the first one, similarity of I and J equal to 1 minus D of object I and J equal to M by P. So this similarity can be computed in the first method for the two different objects. And the same way, the dissimilarity can be computed. D is nothing but here, dissimilarity or distance. So distance between I and J, object I and J equal to P minus M by P. Okay. Where P is the total number of attributes. So these will be computed based on the ratio of mismatch. Why? Because it is a dissimilarity. So this the dissimilarity can be computed based on the ratio of mismatch. In the second method, we can use a large number of binary attributes also. That time you need to create a new binary attribute for each of the M nominal state. You have number of nominal state. For each and every nominal state, you need to create new binary attributes. Suppose when we have an attribute, the attribute may have some weight. Okay, the way if they have any weightage, the weights will also be added or assigned to increase the effect of M having large number of states. So the weights can be assigned to increase the matching effect. Okay, here we are going to match. So matches, M is nothing but the number of matches. To increase the matching effect, we can have weights also. The weights can be assigned for each and every state. Next, we will go for proximity measures for binary attributes. Here you can look at one table. It is given in the right side. So this table contains some values like left side 1, 0, then 1, 0. So it is a binary. Okay. So it is a contingency table for binary data. It is given in here. And here we have some variables also like Q, R, S and T, okay, where the Q is the number of attributes. This will be equal to 1. This will be equal to 1 for object J and equal to 1 for object I also. So in both case, if you take Q for both case object, here you have object J, here you have object I. For both object I as well as J, this Q will be equal to 1. When you take R, okay, the R, this is also number of attributes, but it is equal to 0 for J and equal to 1 for I. But if you take this S, if you take the S, S is in reverse of R. This is also number of attributes, okay, where it is equal to 0 for I and equal to 1 for equal to 1 for J. So these are the values. And this T, mostly we won't consider. Why? Because for the T is equal to 0 for both for both I as well as J. For both I equal to as well as J. So the most of the time the T will not be considered. Okay. So sum you can take. This is a sum. Okay, this is a sum column wise and the row wise this is a sum. And the sums. Now, based on with the help of this contingency table, then symmetric binary state can be computed. Like, okay, for dissimilarity, it is can be computed like D of I comma J equal to R plus S divided by Q plus R plus S plus T. Okay, in case of symmetric, we will consider this value t. Okay, in case of asymmetry, we won't consider the value t here. What in by, you can remember that symmetric binary state and asymmetric binary state. In symmetric binary state, you have two different states. Both states are equally valuable. Okay, for example, you can take gender. Gender, you have female and male female. So both are equal. So you have two different states or two different value. Both are valuable. But in case of asymmetric binary state, here also you have binary state. So two values are there, but it is not equally valuable. In asymmetric, we have, even though we have two states, both are not equally valuable. For example, you can take HIV positive or negative. So 1 and 0 is there, but both are not equal. Okay. So even when it is symmetric, you can compute this dissimilarity. In both the case, we are going to compute dissimilarity. Hereafter, we are always going to consider only this, the dissimilarity. If you have symmetric binary state, what? The dissimilarity can be computed like that. If you have asymmetric binary state, then the dissimilarity will be computed like this. So in formula, there is one difference that in symmetric, you may consider this t value. In asymmetric, you won't consider this t value or in this table. Next, we will consider, we will go for proximity measure for binary attributes. Here that asymmetric binary, previously we have calculated, we have computed dissimilarity. Even in asymmetric binary state, we can compute similarity also. Okay. So we can compute similarity also. Okay. The similarity of the two different objects, I, j equal to q by q plus r plus s. And there is one alternate method for this. That is nothing but Jaucard coefficient. It's a measure of symmetric binary variables. Here, remember, it is a symmetric binary variables. It can be named as coherence, same as coherence. Okay, and that can be defined like coherence equal to q by q plus r plus q plus s minus q. This is a coherence. And the next one is dissimilarity between binary variables. So we see one example, dissimilarity between binary variables. Here, if you take a name, is a table is given, is a patient record table is given over here. Here, the name you can take, this is an object. Okay, name is an object, and gender is an object, is an attribute, but it is a symmetric attribute. Why? Because gender, you have binary state, even though it's a binary state, it is symmetry. Why? Because both male and female are equally valuable. But other than gender, all are asymmetric binary. This is the asymmetric binary. Here you can take let y and p are 1. Y and p are 1. And the n equal to 0. N equal to 0. So with this table, by referring with the previous table, like we have seen the contingency table, and with the help of this formula, we'll be able to compute the dissimilarity between this combination, like Jack and Mary, Jack and Jim, and Jack and Mary. If you compute this dissimilarity for all three pair, you'll be getting different values, like 0.3. 0.67, 0.75. When you look at these three values, 0.75 is the highest value. Here we are going to calculate the dissimilarity. In dissimilarity, if you have higher numerical value, then it is having more dissimilarity between the object. Now, if you take Jim and Mary, when compare all three values, Jim and Mary having high computing value. 0.75. So because of this higher value, the Jim and Mary having more dissimilarity. The remaining two are similarity. Okay, comparatively, compared with Jim and Mary. These values were computed with the help of this formula, which has been discussed in the previous lines. Now, standardizing numeric data. So, numeric data, when you go for any numeric data, first of all, it should be standardized. And to standardize this numeric data, we can go for Z-score. Okay, you can go for a Z score. Z equal to X minus mu by sigma, where X is a raw score to be standardized. And mu is nothing but mu of populations. Again, both will be presented in terms of standard deviation, that is sigma. Okay, so based on these values, we will be able to normalize the numerical values. In alternate way, we will be able to calculate the mean absolute deviation. That is formula is given over here. It is SC equal to 1 by n of x1 minus m plus x2 minus m plus also plus xn minus m. So, by using this formula, you will be able to compute the mean absolute deviations. And standard methods for Z-score can be structured like this. Okay, it is a standardized method, that is a Z-score. The Z-score will help you to normalize the numerical values or numeric attributes. Okay, and using mean absolute deviation is more robust than using standard deviations. You can see another example, data matrix and dissimilarity matrix. Here we have matrix. Here we have data matrix as well as dissimilarity matrix. And here we have one plotter. There you can take points like x1, x2, x3, x4. So these are all the data points or data objects. For each and every object, you have some attributes like attribute 1, attribute 2. For this x1, the value of attribute 1 is 1, and the value of attribute 2 is 2. The same way for object 2, okay, an attribute 1 is 3, and the value for attribute 2 is 5. Okay, like that, we have value for other objects also. And now we can try to plot this value in the plotter. See, for example, if you take x1, okay, the x1, so x1 is plotted in 1, it is the 1 value, and then this is the 2 value. Okay, so the x1 is placed x1 and 2. So this will be placed like this here. It is a place like this. It is the x1. Okay, and same way for x2. X2 you can have 3 and 5. In x-axis 3. In x-axis it is a 3. Okay, it is a 3. And y-axis it is a 5. Here it is a 5. Okay, so if you draw like this, and here it will be, x2 will be plotted like that. For all the object, it will be plotted in the matrix, the plotter. And same way, we can take dissimilarity matrix also. Here, this will be calculated based on the Euclidean distance. Here you have different objects like x1, x2, x3, x4. And same way, here also we have x1, x2, x3, x4. Okay, this is a matrix format. It's a two mode, this is a single mode. And here if you have x1, x1, it's a dissimilarity. If you have x1, x1, the value will be 0. Okay, if you have x2, x2, the value will be 0. If you have x3, x3, the value will be 0. And if you have x4, x4, this value will be 0. Okay, so the remaining value will have a dissimilarity. This is a higher value. So this will show the dissimilarity between the two objects. And the other remaining value x12 and 21 will not be shown in the table. Okay, so this is with the Euclidean distance. Next, we will go for dissimilarity of numeric data Minkowski distance. And this distance measures are commonly used for computing and dissimilarity of the object described by the numeric attributes. There are three different popular dissimilarity measures are there. They are all Euclidean, Mankhurten and Minkowski distances. And Euclidean, it is one of the most popular distance. Here, for example, if you take object like I, one object, and J is another object. So I is having some attributes like x1, x2, so on, so x, some values. Okay, xi, in, and j same as j equal to xj1, xj2, so on, so xjn. And the two objects, for these two objects, if you try to find out the distance measure by using Euclidean distance, this will be computed by this formula, like this. Okay, the Euclidean distance between two objects I and j is computed like this: d of I comma j equal to root of x minus x whole square plus same way x2 xi2 minus xj2 square plus so and so xip minus xjp square. So this is the Euclidean distance. Euclidean distance is one of the popular method to measure the distance between two different objects. And same way, Mankhurten, it is another one. Here the difference between these two, here also it will help you to measure the distance, but the distance will be in two different points in the block. Okay, so when you have a block of data, there if you try to find out the distance between two points, then you can always, you can go for this method, Mankhurten or city block distance measure. Now we'll go to the Minkowski distance. The Minkowski distance is a popular distance measure. It is the generalization of the Euclidean as well as Mankhurten distance. It can be defined like d of dissimilarity of or distance of I and j equal to root of xi1 minus xj1 whole h. Okay, and here if you see this formula, if you see this one, here you have h, everywhere you have given h. Here the x is in other way it is defined like it is the order. Okay, it is the order. That is a distance, so is defined also called a LH norm. Well, there is a norm, okay, in which it is defined. Okay, and where I equal to some attribute values. I and J are two different attributes with the P dimensional. I and J are two different objects with the P dimensional data objects. And properties, these are all the properties. See, for example, if you take ti comma j greater than 0, that means the distance between I and j, if it is greater than 0, that means I and j are not equal, and d of I comma I equal to 0, that is positive derivatives. It is a properties we have to remember. See, the distance between I and j is greater than 0, or if you take I and j, that is not equal. And if you take I and I, if you take distance between two same attribute, if you take same data object, if you take I, the d of I and I, if we equal to 0, then it is positive definiteness. The other property is d of I comma j equal to d of j comma I, same thing. Okay, then it is symmetry. You have here, you have two different object, but both are equally valuable. That is symmetry. The other property is d of I comma j less than or equal to d of I comma k plus d of k comma j. Then it will be triangular inequality. Then it will be triangular, and you can see this dissimilarity data matrix. There you can check it out. It is a triangle inequality. And the distance that satisfies these properties is a metric. Now we'll go for the example for Minkowski distance. It is a dissimilarity matrix. Here we already seen the same table, like if you take a table, there you have different points like x1, x2, x3, x4. Okay, for these are all the data objects. For each and every object you have different attributes. Here we have taken two different attributes, like attribute 1 and attribute 2. Okay, for each and every object you have some values for each and every data object we have some attribute values, like an attribute 1 the value is 1 and attribute 2 the value is 2. Like that, for each and every attribute or data object you have some attribute values, and with this table you can compute the dissimilarity matrix for Mankerton formulas, for Euclidean and for supernum. Okay, in different way we'll be able to find out the dissimilarity matrix with respect to this base table. The same value can be plotted in the graph, okay, which was discussed already in the previous slides. Now we'll go for ordinal variables. In ordinal variables, it may be discrete or continuous. For example, when you take a rank, so rank will be either 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, like that you may have. But each and every rank is a discrete value. There is no need to have any continuity. Or if you want, you can have continuity also, like rank 1, rank 2, rank 3, rank 4. Like that also you can have continuations, or you can have discrete also. And it is sequence and small, medium and large. So there will be a sequence. If you have any data, there will be some sequence. For example, if you take small, medium, large, there also you have some sequence. First small, then medium, then large. There is some sequence. So in ordinal variable, it can be discrete or continuous variable. Continuous values. And it can be treated like interval scaled. It can be treated as interval scale. For example, it is interval scale is something, but it's a categories. Here you have different categories like cold temperature and moderate temperature and warm temperature. You need to define the value. It is a discrete. You need to specify the order over here. Okay. It is a discrete value. Like the cold temperature. If you have temperature like that, this much, then you may have cold temperature. If you have temperature like this, then it is a moderate temperature. If you have temperature like this, then it is a warm temperature. Like that, it is a discrete value. There is no need to have any specific order over here. And this can be replaced by the rank also. Like for example, cold is 1, moderate is 2, and warm is 3. Or warm is 1, moderate is 2, and cold is 3. Like that, you can have some rank. Okay, so these can replace by their rank. And same way, when you take a map, the map range of each variable will be 0 to 0 or 0.1. Okay, so 0.1, 0.0 to 0.1 and 0.2, like that it may go. So that may be by replacing ith object in the fth variable I. Then now the standard, it is a numerical value. You can standardize the value by using z score. Okay. By using z score, you'll be able to compute these variables like this. And this computing dissimilarity using methods for interval scaled variables. And it is very important concept over here to be discussed is a ordinal variable is mostly we are using. It may be discrete or continuous, and it may be numeric or any other variables. Then sometimes we may have some mixed type of attributes. This database may contain all types of attributes. Say for example, we already discussed different types of attributes. Different types of attributes can be presented in the same database. For example, nominal attributes, symmetric binary attributes, asymmetric binary attributes, numeric ordinal values, Okay, like that you may have all different types of attributes can be presented in the same database itself. So that time by using some weighted formula, you will be able to compute their effect. So this will be the formula which is used with weights. So everywhere you need to have you need to compute the weight. Here f is the binary or nominal attributes, where you can understand this d I j f. If it is zero, it is a zero, the condition will be if if equal to jf. See, remember, if both are same, that is similar, then the value will be zero. Why? Because here always we are trying to look for dissimilarity, and dissimilarity in the sense, if both are not equal, then the value will be 1. That means what? We have dissimilarities, and it is a numeric. If it is a numeric, you can go for normalized distance. That means you can go for Euclidean distance or Minkowski distance. And it is, if it is ordinal, then you can compute rank. Okay, or you can treat Z score as a interval scaled. That means that is nothing but the score will be the score formula is given over here, r minus 1 by m minus 1. Okay. Right. So these are all the mixed type of attributes. Next, cosine similarity. This is cosine similarity mostly will be used for document retrieval. So when you go to web, there you have large number of documents. Each and every document can be represented by thousands of attributes, and each one recording the frequency of the particular word. So for example, if you take a document, the document will have more and more number of attributes, and each and every attribute value will have some frequency. Why? Because for example, if you take word, say for data mining. So data mining is the word which can be presented mostly in the sense, then the frequency of the data mining is very high. Okay, based on this the such type of keywords, the document can be retrieved. So sample is given over here. So purely this cosine similarity can be used for used to compare the document, and you can say some ranking of the document based on the content, based on the attribute values, based on the frequency of the attribute value presented in the document. So like that you have some conditions. So based on these conditions, the cosine similarity will try to find out the required document, and this document can be retrieved. So everywhere such keyword can be used. And this for this we have computed formula. See, the cosine measure, if d1 and d2 are two vectors, see d1, that is example term frequency vectors, okay, two vectors, okay, then the cosine similarity can be computed like d1 dot d2, that is a product by d1 model d1 model d2. So by using this formula, you will be able to compute the cosine similarity. We'll see one example. So the cosine similarity here, the formula is given. Okay, so the formula is given where indicates the vector dot product and model the length of the vector. So here we can understand what is given in the formula. Now we can take two different documents. This one document is another document. So by using these two documents, we may go for cosine similarity. Here first you can take this first one, d1 dot d2. Then you can take d1. Then you can take d2. So one by one you can take, say, d1 dot d2. Then d1 value. Then d2 value. So by using these values, by using this formula, okay, you can compute the cosine similarity. That is nothing but 0.94. Okay, so like that you can find out this quotient similarity by computing the values by using this formula. Okay, thank you.